شبیک یا حسین، ایک اور قدم ہو گئے شبیر کے نزدیک، ایک اور قدم ہو گئے شبیر کے نزدیک۔
یہ میرا رضا ہے، عزادار ہوں مولا، پابل دیے دنیا میں گرفتار ہوں مولا، مرضی کا کہاں مالک مختار ہوں مولا، کیسے ہو زیارت میں گناہ گار ہوں مولا۔
باللہ من الشیطان الرجیم، بسم اللہ الرحمن الرحیم، صلی اللہ علیک یا رسول اللہ، صلی اللہ علیک وعلا اہل بیتک المظلومین، صلی اللہ علیک یا ابا عبد اللہ، صلى الله عليك يا ابن رسول الله، يا رحمة الله الواسعة، ويا باب نجاة الأمة، ما خاب من تمسك بكم وأمن من لجأ إليكم، يا ليتنا يا ليتنا كنا معكم سادتي، فنفوز فوزا عظيما۔ قال الله تعالى في كتابه المجيد، بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، الذين يذكرون الله قياما وقعودا وعلى جنوبهم ويتفكرون في خلق السماوات والأرض، ربنا ما خلقت هذا باطلا سبحانك فقنا عذاب النار۔ آمنا بالله، صدق الله العلي العظيم، اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد۔ Respected brothers and sisters, السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته۔ الحمد لله، we thank Allah سبحانه وتعالى، Allah the one who made us to meet again in this Islamic New Year which begins with the month of Muharram. We are all aware that there are some brothers and sisters within us who have preceded us. They have passed away. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala have mercy on all of them. We pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that inshallah within these 10 or 11 or 12 nights of majalis of Aba Abdullah al-Husayn alayhi salam, we will be able inshallah to participate in commemoration of the martyrdom of Aba Abdullah al-Husayn, the one who is Qatilul Abarat. The one, whenever we remember him, we find that in his martyrdom there is a lesson. And inshallah, through these majalis, we are going to talk about the lessons from Karbala, because Karbala is madrasa. Karbala is madrasa not only for those people who just came immediately after the event of Karbala, but Karbala is madrasa for us, and we are going to learn many lessons from Imam Abi Abdullah and those chosen companions who were with him. And inshallah, from those lessons, we will try to ask Allah to make us to be able to implement those lessons in our daily lives, inshallah ta'ala. So my theme for this year, inshallah, will be lessons from Karbala. And these lessons from Karbala, we will discuss about different subtopics, which we will mention each topic every night. And tonight, inshallah ta'ala, I want to talk about the importance of doing bahth or research for the events which happen during the history from Karbala up to our days today and these days, since we see that there are few views when it comes to Karbala. People are looking to the event of Karbala in different perspectives. We want to look at those and to find which one is the most appropriate for us to look at and to revisit the history in order for us to learn different lessons, insha'Allah ta'ala. As normal, I will divide my lecture into two languages, into Arabic and English, in order to accommodate for those brothers and sisters who don't speak English, for us at least to give them the bullet points of what we are going to discuss, insha'Allah ta'ala. Al-Bahthu wa Tahqiq fi Sirat al-Husayniya qadiyya muhimma jiddan binisbat lana ka'atba' madhab ahli al-bayt alayhim as-salam. Hinama nanzur ila Karbala najid anna hunaka durus kathira wa hadhihi ad-durus la budda lana an nadrusaha min jadid haythu na'lam anna ما حدث في كربلاء لم تكن فقط واقعة تاريخية وانتهت في كربلاء بل كربلاء حي إلى هذا اليوم وهناك دروس كثيرة علينا أن ندرسها وإن شاء الله في هذه المحاضرات نسأل الله سبحانه وتعالى أن يوفقنا في إلقاء ما نراه من الدروس المهمة ولا يمكن أن نلتفت إليها كلها ولكن سنحاول أن ننظر إلى تلك الدروس التي ندرسها من مدرسة كربلاء حيث الإمام الحسين عليه السلام وجل من صحابته الذين كانوا معه أولئك المطهرون الذين كانوا مع الإمام عليه السلام طهرهم الله لأجل أبي عبد الله عليه السلام هناك دروس كثيرة علينا أن ندرسها وهذه الدروس سوف إن شاء الله نتطرق إليها في كل ليلة حتى ننتهي إلى ماذا نستفيد في حضورنا لهذه المجالس القيمة حيث نحيي شعائر الحسينية فكربلاء لم تكن كما قلت واقعة تاريخية انتهت هناك لكن هناك الكثير التي جرت وحينما نتكلم عن البحث والتحقيق في السيرة الحسينية علينا أن نعرف أن هذه الوقائع التاريخية بعضها ليست صحيحة بعضها نعم صحيحة ولكن كيف ننظر إلى كربلاء وهذا هو الأمر المهم إن شاء الله سوف نتكلم كما هي العادة باللغتين الإنجليزية والعربية حتى يعني نشارك في فهم هذه الدروس معنا إن شاء الله تعالى يقول الله سبحانه وتعالى في سورة آل عمران آية 191 الذين يذكرون الله قياما وقعودا وعلى جنوبهم ويتفكرون في خلق السماوات والأرض ربنا ما خلقت هذا باطلا سبحانك فقنا عذاب النار هذه الآية حينما ننظر إليها تجعلنا أن نتدبر وأن نفكر في خلق السماوات الله هو الذي يأمرنا بذلك الذين يذكرون الله قياما وقعودا وعلى جنوبهم هنا قضية مهمة وهي ذكر الله إذا أردنا أن نبقى أحياء علينا أن نذكر الله سبحانه وتعالى أحياء بمعنى أحياء روحيا وليس أحياء جسميا إذا أردنا أن نبقى أحياء روحيا علينا أن نذكر الله سبحانه وتعالى في كل الحالات الله هنا يذكر قياما وقعودا وعلى جنوبهم يعني في كل الحالات ثم الله يقول في نفس الآية ويتفكرون في خلق السماوات والأرض هؤلاء الذين يذكرون الله قياما وقعودا وعلى جنوبهم يتفكرون والفكر هنا يعني ينظرون إلى خلق الله بالدقة والإمعان ثم يقولون ربنا ما خلقت هذا باطلا سبحانك فقنا عذاب النار تفكيرهم إلى خلق السماوات والأرض وما فيهما وما بينهما يَجْعَلُهَا أُولَىٰ أَنْ يَقُولُ سُبْحَانَكَ وَنَحْنُ نَسْأَلُ اللَّهَ سُبْحَانَهُ وَتَعَالَىٰ أَنْ يَجْعَلَنَا مِنْ أُولَائِكَ حَيْثُ لَوْ تَرَكْنَا ذِكْرِ اللَّهِ سَنَكُونُ فِي الْغَفْلَةِ وَالْغَفْلَةِ هِيَ أَسَاسُ الظَّلَالِ وَالشَّيْطَانُ وَالْمُغْرَيَاتِ تُغْرِينَ حِينَمَا نَكُونُ فِي الظَّلَالِ وَالظَّلَالُ تَبْدَأُ مِنَ الْغَفْلَةِ Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala la yuriduna an nakuna minal ghafilin. Respected brothers and sisters, when we start our discussion, we look at ayah number 191 in Surah Al-Imran. The most important ayah when it comes to our daily lives. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Alladhina yadhkuruna Allaha qiyaman wa qu'udan wa ala junubihim. Among the best qualities of the servants of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, those who are aware that they are servants of Allah, يَذْكُرُونَ اللَّهَ, they remember Allah. They mention Allah, قِيَامًا, while standing up, وَقُعُودًا, while sitting down, وَعَلَى جُنُوبِهِمْ, while they are lying on their sides. It means that if we want to be alive spiritually, we need to mention Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in all the cases. And it is as if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, if you want to remember Allah while standing up, do it. You want to remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala while sitting down, do it. You want to remember Allah if you are tired, you can't stand up, you can't sit down, lie on your side. All these cases will make you to go closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And not only that, when you mention Allah all the time, there will be no any room of shaitan to come and confuse you. There will be no any room for you to follow your desires, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will be with you all the time. So when you mention Allah, either by subhanallah, or alhamdulillah, or la ilaha illallah, O Allahu Akbar, or just by saying salawat ala Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad. Muhammad wa Ali. By mentioning all these adhkar, we will be alive. And if we don't mention these adhkar and we don't mention Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we don't remember Him, then we become like dead people. Yes, we will be walking. Yes, we will be talking. Yes, we will be eating and drinking, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will not be there for us. So when that happens, that is the state which is known as ghafla, heedless, or heedlessness. When we are in heedlessness, that state, we forget Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the problem will not be for Him, the problem will be for us. Allah will never forget us because He has created us. But it is we, when we come to the state of heedlessness, we forget Allah, then the problems which will happen to us, number one, we will forget ourselves. وَلَا تَكُونُ كَالَّذِينَ نَسُوا اللَّهَ فَأَنْسَاهُمْ أَنْفُسَهُمْ. Don't be like those people who forget Allah. When you forget Allah, Allah will make you to forget yourself. And when we forget ourselves, we come to the state of ghafla. This state is the state which we will follow our desires, and we will be like baha'im, like animals. Ula'ika kal an'am, will become like animals. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, balhum adhal, we will be worse than animals. So Allah, when He talks in this ayah number 191, alladhina yadhkuruna Allaha qiyaman wa qu'udan wa ala junubihim, He says, wa yatafakkaruna fi khalqis samawati wal ard. They think about the creation of Allah in terms of the heavens and the earth. They look at the creation of Allah and they say, Subhanak, glory be to you. Ma khalaqta hadha batila. You did not create the heavens and the earth and whatever is in between them or with them without any purpose, without any aim. You created the sky, the earth, the stars, the moon and the sun for a reason. And when you think like that, you connect your thinking with the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, many things happen there. Number one, Tawheed. Tawheed fil khaliqiyya. You know that the creator is Allah. The heaven and the earth and whatever is between them did not create themselves by themselves, but the creator is Allah. When you know that, you appreciate Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by saying, Subhanak, glory be to you. What does glory be to you means? There is no any deficiency in your creation. Your creation is perfect. And that's why I glorify you by saying Subhanak. And then we ask Allah, Rabbana faqina adhab an-nar. O our Lord, protect us from the hellfire. Because if we are in heedless, then it is easy for us to sleep and we will be taken to hellfire. And that hellfire will start here in this life. The way Allah says in the Holy Quran about the day of Yawm al-Qiyamah, that there will be some people who, because they have lost the touch with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He says their lives in this world will be so difficult because they were in ghafla. Ma'ishatan dhanka wa nahshuruhu yawm al-qiyamati a'ma. Qala rabbi lima hashartani a'ma wa kad kuntu basira. Qala kad Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will say that our verses came to you, but you kept them aside. It means you became forgetfulness. You became heedless. You didn't pay attention to whatever we say. وَكَذَلِكَ الْيَوْمَ تُنْسَى. And that's why today you will be forgotten. So the most important thing in this ayah number 191, and I would ask, if possible, especially for the young audience, young brothers and sisters, when we mention these verses, note them down. When you go home in the weekend, you get time, look at them again. This is the way we will learn from the Madrasa Al-Husayniya, salawatullahi alayhi wa salamuhu, sallu ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. So in these, inshallah, nights of Muharram, we will be trying to discuss about the lessons from Karbala, from Aba Abdullah and those companions Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala chose them for him, and they chose Imam Abi Abdullah for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And there will be many lessons. Today and tonight I want to talk about the research which we need to do when we come to the stories of Karbala. We will find that there are few people who have different perspectives when it comes to Karbala. There are many people, they wear glasses, lenses, and they look at Karbala from different lenses. These lenses, some of them are correct, some of them are not. So what can we do in order for us to be with Aba Abdullah? And these will be our lessons. Qala Rasulullah Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. Husaynun minni wa ana min Husayn. Ahabba Allahu man ahabba Husayna. Rasulullah says in this hadith, very important, Husaynun minni wa ana min Husayn. Husayn is from me and I am from Husayn. Lesson number one. Husaynun minni, Husayn comes from me. We know that. Rasulullah was the grandfather of Husayn. Imam Husayn is the son of Fatima al-Zahra and Ali ibn Abi Talib salawatullahi wa salamuhu alayhima. Husaynun minni, it's clear. Lakin wa ana min Husayn. It is here from this madrasa of Aba Abdullah we need to think. What does it mean, wa ana min Husayn? Kaifa ya'ni Rasulullah min Husayn? Wa huwa kana awwalan qabla al-Husayn. La yumkin an yataqaddam al-Husayn ala al-Rasul. Wa ana min Husayn. When we look at this part, second part of the hadith, it means that Husayn, with his stance, Husayn, with his firm conviction that he will protect Islam, Rasulullah says, wa ana min Husayn. Meaning what? Our stance are one. The way I look at Islam, it is exactly the way Husayn will look at Islam. The way I am ready to be sacrificed for this religion, for example, when Rasulullah was preaching Islam And he went to Ta'if. The way he was tortured, Jibreel came to Rasulullah. And he said, Ya Rasulullah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, the only thing you need to do is say, destroy them, and I will destroy them. But Rasulullah says, no, don't do that. Why? He says, because from these evil people, the children will be born, and they will become, maybe they will become good Muslims. And fi'lan, that is what happened. Imam Abi Abdullah al-Hussein in Karbala, we look at him, he would ask Allah, if he wanted, he would raise his hands, and he would say, Ya Allah, destroy these people now, so that there will be no any war, no battle, nothing. But he didn't do that. Every time he was talking to them, even at the last moments when Shimri was about to behead Abi Abdullah, Imam Hussein was talking to them and saying that, you don't know who I am. You don't know that I am Ibn Rasulullah. You don't know, and so on and so forth. He was preaching to them even at the last moments. Rasulullah is Nabiyur Rahma. Imam Hussein, Imamur Rahma. Wa ana min Hussein. When we look at this hadith number one, we think about that, then we come to learn that, yes, Imam Hussein followed the same footsteps of Rasulullah. And then the Holy Prophet says, Ahabballahu man ahabba Husayna. Anyone who likes Hussein, Allah will like him. Anyone who dedicates his life for Hussein, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will pay attention to him. Anyone, for example, in these majalis, you sit down, you listen to the khutbah, you listen to the lecture, you contribute in one way or the other, you help the people to commemorate the azah of Aba Abdullah, Ahabballahu man ahabba Husayna. Allah will like you. Why? Because you revive this message of Karbala. And that's why when we look at A'imma al-Athhar alayhi musallam, we see them that Qadiyya of Karbala, it was their Qadiyya. Whenever you talk to Aba Abdullah, Imam Sadiq alayhi salam, Abu Abdullah al-Sadiq alayhi salam, or you talk to any other Imam, you would see that they would talk about the Qadiyya of Karbala. And it is here when we talk about Al-Bahth wa Tahqiq fi Sira al-Husayniya, Nara Thalath Ittijahat. Al-Ittijahu Taqlidi wal-Ittijahu Al-Madi aw Al-Ilmani wal-Ittijahu Al-Ilmi Ad-Dini. Al-Ittijahu Taqlidi huwa alladhi yaqulu lana la nuridu illa an nasma'a tilka al-qisas التاريخية كما ورثناه من آبائنا وأجدادنا لا نريد تغيير ولا نريد هذا ولا ذاك نريد أن نسمع نفس المحاضرة في كل سنة ولا نريد أي بديل اتجاه تقليد ولا تقول لهم علينا أن ننظر إلى الأحاديث لعل هناك ضعف أو ما شابه ذلك في السند الاتجاه التقليد يقول لك لا لا نريد ذلك والاتجاه الثاني الاتجاه المادي العلماني هو الذي يبحث عن ثغرات في حياة الإمام الحسين في أصحاب الحسين في قضية كربلاء وهؤلاء هم المشككون الذين يتكلمون بدون خوف وليس ولا يبالون في أن الحسين كان معصوما أو ما شابه ذلك وعددهم يزداد يوميا في العالم وهناك الاتجاه الثالث وهو الاتجاه العلم الديني الذي يقول نعم صحيح قضية الحسين عليه السلام قضية كبيرة معركة كربلاء معركة مهمة ولكن هناك بعض الأمور قد يكون أننا نقلد وليس أمورا حقيقيا علينا أن ننظر إلى التاريخ مرة أخرى ونفعل كما يفعل المجتهدون يجتهدون وإذا أصابوا أصابوا وإذا أخطأوا أخطأوا ولكن يقولون علينا أن نقوم بالبحث والتدقيق. When we look at the research which we need to do when we come to the majalis of Aba Abdullah al-Hussein alayhi salam, we find that there are three ways of looking at the history of Aba Abdullah al-Hussein. The first approach is the approach which is known as approach which is on the basis of tradition, traditional approach. The people who comes Muharram, they go to the majalis, they listen to the lectures, they have the opinion that we have to follow the tradition. Whatever the tradition says, we have to do that. For example, if I come from Africa, I saw my fathers, they commemorate Majlis of Aba Abdullah in a particular way, I will want my children to follow exactly the same way which I followed. People from Iran, they do the same. For us, Aba Abdullah, we have to commemorate his Shahada this way. You can't do it the other way around. When you go, for example, to India or Pakistan, you have to follow exactly the way your forefathers taught you. You go to Iraq, it's the same way. And maybe in Iraq, southern part, northern part, they have their own styles. We have to follow the traditions. And it is this approach, which is taqlidi, traditional approach, which says, we don't want to hear anything regarding Ba'th. Don't tell us about research. Don't speak about this is right or wrong. We want to hear the same story of Aba Abdullah from day one, day two, day three, until the day of Ashura, exactly the way we had the story of Aba Abdullah last year and many years before. When you go to the second approach, the second approach is the dangerous one. Al-Ittijahul Madi or Al-Ilmani, this is the approach which doesn't care about research. They don't care about whatever you do. The only thing they care is to poke holes in the life of Aba Abdullah al-Hussein. They are talking like people who are not religious. And in fact, they are not. And their number, unfortunately, is increasing. They will look at Aba Abdullah and they say that he was just like any other politicians, for example. He wanted to challenge Yazid. And he lost the battle. He was killed, and end of the story. For us, we say, Astaghfirullah. How can you talk about Aba Abdullah like this? But for them, this is their way. And unfortunately, when we go to the universities, we find that the students who graduate from Islamic sections of universities, they have this approach. And when you talk to them about Aba Abdullah, that he was ma'asum and so on and so forth, they say, well, we need to look at the issues academically. We have to have academic approach. Then they treat Aba Abdullah like any other politician. And these are the dangerous people. Whenever they find any opportunity to poke holes even to your life, they will come and say, you know what? What is this tradition? Don't do matam. Latmiya, keep it aside. You don't need to do anything in the name of Aba Abdullah al-Hussein. And they will propagate their messages whenever they find a chance to do that, they will do that. However, we have the third approach. The third approach is the one which says that we as Muslims, we follow the religion of Islam. We know that Rasulullah came to preach Islam. And after him, A'imma, alayhimus salam. And of course, Imam Abi Abdullah al-Hussein alayhi salam came. Waqi'at Karbala happened. The story which was written to us or for us after Karbala, there are many traditions. Some of them are not authentic. Some of them are authentic. We need to do research the way our maraji of fiqh, jurisprudential issues, they do ijtihad. They do research. They come to the traditions and they say, for example, this tradition is not correct, that one is correct, we take it. And when it comes to the azah of Aba Abdullah alayhi salam, we find that we need to do research exactly the way our scholars have done when it comes to the issues of fiqh. And it is this approach which says that we need to be very careful. Number one, who is giving the lecture? And for what reason? What is the resources which he refers to when he recites the Majalis of Aba Abdullah? Because Rasulullah Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wasallam, Rasulullah says, لَقَدْ كَثُرَتِ الْكَذَّابَ وَسَتَكْثُرُ. فَمَنْ كَذَّبَ عَلَيَّ مُتَعَمِّدًا فَلْيَتَبَوَّأْ مَقْعَدَهُ مِنَ النَّارِ. Rasulullah says there are many liars while he was alive. Liars, they are increasing in numbers. And there will be even more after my death. And the Holy Prophet said, anyone who will fabricate a story that he says, I said something while I did not say, let him prepare his abode to be in hell. Now, if Rasulullah said that, do you think people who fabricated the hadith at the time of the Holy Prophet, they cannot fabricate a hadith at the time of Aba Abdullah al-Hussein? And especially after the death of Aba Abdullah al-Hussein. And it is here we need to be very careful. Which hadith do we take? We shouldn't be fooled by saying that the event of Karbala, it was history. Anyone who talks about the history of Karbala, he's right. No, there are many people who their aim is to destroy Islam within. And the enemies of Madhab of Ahlul Bayt, they have said many times that these Shias, we see them, what unites them is their maraji and of course the event of Karbala. If we want to destroy them, we destroy the establishment of Marja'iyya, destroy the stories of Aba Abdullah, so that they will be confused. And we need to be aware of that. And that's why when we find this approach, we say, Alhamdulillah, that there are people and many scholars have spent their lives in order for them to make sure that this approach is going to be alive. I know, for example, in London, UK, there is one organization. The scholar of that organization spent the whole of his life just to make sure that he will find any narration wherever it is which is connected with Aba Abdullah al-Hussein alayhi salam. And he decided, I will publish 500 books, 500 volumes, in order for me to talk about Imam Abi Abdullah al-Hussein from different angles. Unfortunately, these centers, research centers, we don't see the importance of them. And sometimes even our contributions when it comes to monetary contribution is not there. So what do we expect that we will get something good from these centers if we don't help them? And it is here we need to be aware. And Alhamdulillah, many centers these days are aware of the fabricators of the Masail, which are talking about Abi Abdullah al-Hussein alayhi salam. هذا الاتجاه العلمي يسأل عن الحقيقة. ما هي الحقيقة في قضية كربلاء؟ والاتجاه يفكر هل معقول أنه حدث كذا وكذا؟ ويبحث ويدقق. وفي النهاية هذا الاتجاه يريد أن يقوم بعمل. فما هو العمل؟ هذا الاتجاه لا يقول فقط علينا أن نحضر المجالس ونحن نسمع المحاضرات ثم تنتهي الأمور ونلتقي سنة القادمة. لا. ماذا علينا أن نقوم به؟ This third approach is very important for us to talk about it, because it is this approach which says we need to think. Did it really happen the way we hear that, for example, this story happened? And if it happened, what does it mean? What are the lessons which we are learning? And what can we do? Now, when we go this way, Ashura, Karbala will have a meaning. Rather than to say, let us just meet, let us listen, let us make aza, majlis, matam, and then we go home. And then when we compare ourselves to the enemies of Aba Abdullah, we don't see any differences. How many times, wallah, unfortunately, we attend the majalis of Aba Abdullah. We cry for Aba Abdullah. When we go outside of majalis, we forget the majlis and we become like the enemies of Aba Abdullah. What's wrong with us? It means that we did not pay attention. We took it in a tradition way. I will get thawab. There is barakah for me to attend majlis of Aba Abdullah. Yes, there is barakah. There is thawab. But Imam Abi Abdullah doesn't want us only to get thawab. He said, "Hal min nasirin yansuruna?" Is there any helper to help us? not to help us in barakah and thawab. La. Hal min nasirin yansuruna yansur risala al-Husayniya. And this is exactly what Aba Abdullah wanted us to do. When we look at Karbala as madrasa, we see that this is madrasa tarbawiyya. Karbala hiya madrasatun tarbawiyya au al-madrasatu tarbawiyya. Turabbina. Many a times, kathiran ma ra'ayna, wallah, annas lam yakunu muslimin. Aw kanu muslimina, walakin lam yuwalu ahl al-bayt. Bisababi madrasati ahl al-bayt, madrasat Karbala tahawalu. Waswaru muwalin. Ana a'rif shakhsan, alladhi wulida musliman, walakin lam yakun muwali li ahl al-bayt. Hadara majalis li abi abdillah, وبعد انتهاء هذه المجالس 12 يوما تحول جذريا لماذا يقول لي انني لم اكن اعرف من هذا الحسين عرفت الحسين في هذه المجالس هذا هو الاتجاه الصحيح I when I talk about Karbala as madrasa tarbawiya madrasa which can nurture us in terms of our morality I know a person who wasn't A follower of Ahlul Bayt. He was born as a Muslim, yes, but he didn't know about Abdullah al-Hussein. And unfortunately, you know what is happening? We, when we talk about Aba Abdullah, we keep him in our Husayniyas only. Imam Hussein is here only. Outside there, people don't know him. But alhamdulillah, the young people, good what they do these days. They do different activities to make people to be aware of Aba Abdullah. This young man, attended a majlis of Imam Hussein for 12 days. Listening the story of Aba Abdullah from day 1 until day 12, he changed completely. He followed Aba Abdullah. When he was asked, what made you to change? He said, Imam Hussein alayhi salam. Why? He said, I didn't know him. I was a Muslim. I was born as a Muslim. But I didn't know Imam Hussein the way you guys know about Imam Hussein alayhi salam. He changed completely. Why? Because this madrasa of Karbala nurtured him. And it is this nurturing of Karbala, we need to take it to people in order for them to understand Aba Abdullah al-Hussein. Madrasatul Qiyam. Karbala, madrasatul Qiyam. Hatha hur, alladhi kana aduwan lil imam al-Hussein. Ba'da an ra'a akhlaq wa qiyam abi Abdullah wa ashabihi. تحول إذا تحول حور إلى من أتباع وصار من أتباع الحسين معناه ماذا الكل ممكن يتغير ويصير مثل الحور when we look at مدرسة كربلاء we find that this is a madrasa which is on the basis of principles you look at حور you wonder what made him to change when حور was asked he said I was looking at Aba Abdullah al-Hussein and his companions. I was so attracted by the way Imam Hussein is leading Salah. And they are ready to pray behind him. They all work like one family. They support one another. He says, this made me to be attracted by this madrasa. And if Hur could change, anyone could change else. Anyone can change even now. And that's why this young man said, Imam Hussein, I didn't know. I knew the name Hussein. But I didn't know the principles of Hussein. So when we talk about this madrasa of Karbala, it's madrasatul qiyam wal akhlaq. Lakin hadhihi al madrasa nahnu ja'alnaha madrasa atifiyya faqat. Nabki na'saf lima jara fi Karbala. Hadha jayyid. Al buka jayyid wallah. Lakin la nantahi faqat ila al buka. Al buka wasila. لِيَأْخُذَنَا إِلَى الْحُسَيْنَ عَلَيْهِ السَّلَامِ وَإِلَى أَبْعَدْ مِنْ ذَلِكَ When we look at the madrasa of Karbala, unfortunately, we find that most of us, including myself, we like to cry only. And how many times, brothers, you come to the speaker and you say, you know what? We want to hear the musiba of Aba Abdullah. We want to cry. I was at one particular center here in America, And the brothers came to me and they say, Moulana, make us cry. We want to cry properly. And I was like, yes, yes, you're going to cry, inshallah. But then I was thinking, you want to cry for Aba Abdullah, or you want to cry for your own issues which happen, and you want to cry in order for you to cry? And then what after the cries? Madrasa of Aba Abdullah to cry is good. These tears which we shed when we hear the story of Aba Abdullah, they clean us. And it is very important. The way we are going to mention A'imma alayhimu salam, they actually ask people to cry. It is good. But when we cry, this should be wasila ila al-hadaf. Al-hadaf an-nasira bisirati Abi Abdullah al-Husayn. We shouldn't end with the cries only, because we can cry here when we go outside. If we have no change in our hearts, we'll become like the enemies of Aba Abdullah al-Husayn alayhi salam. When we look at Madrasat Karbala, we need to bring it into our houses to say, if I am not a good father, from Imam Abi Abdullah alayhi salam and his companions, I need to change to become a good father to my children. Because Imam Hussein alayhi salam, look at this point. He didn't say to the children, you stay back in Medina, I will go alone. Qasim, you are son of my brother, I don't want to take you, stay in Medina, keep Qasim in Medina. 13 years old, yeah, boy. Lakin Imam Hussein said what? We are going together. A father who cares for his children, he will be ready to take them where he believes. And this is what we see in the event of Mubahala. Rasulullah Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. Why he comes out with Imam al-Hasan wal-Husayn? Abna'ana. They were young. It's because he believes in the principles of truth. That if we are going to die, we will die all of us. But if we are going to be saved, we will be saved all of us. So for us, Karbala, if you are a father, you need to take care of your children this way. If you are a mother, you see Sayyida Zainab salamullahi alayha. You see the wives of Aba Abdullah. They were there. Imam Hussein, it was easy for him to say, you women, ladies, listen, stay. This journey is a dangerous one. But he knew for them to be in Karbala, they will always be elevated until the day of Yawm al-Qiyamah. And that's why we remember Zainab, we remember all the ladies who were there in Karbala. Now, when we talk about Buka li Abi Abdullah al-Husayn, nara anna al-a'imma alayhimu salam kulluhum shajja'u al-Buka. Shajja'u al-Buka. Hatta limadha? لأن البكاء سوف يجعلنا أن نرتقي إلى قضية الحسين قضية وليس حسين شخصا إذا نحن نرتقي إلى قضية الحسين سنتغير جذريا ولذلك الأئمة عليهم السلام شجعوا قضية البكاء. When we look at أئمة عليهم السلام, for Aba Abdullah in Karbala, this was their mission. Subhanallah, you look at Imam al-Hasan alayhi salam, his mission was to fight against Muawiyah, the cunning one. But Imam Hussein alayhi salam, his qadiyya, Imam Hassan alayhi salam, his qadiyya was not just Muawiyah, his qadiyya was Aba Abdullah. And that's why when we remember the musibah, yeah? When Imam Hassan alayhi salam was about to die, he was given that poison. Imam Hassan alayhi salam, he is vomiting blood. Imam Hussein is near his brother. Imam Hassan says to Imam Hussein, close the door. I don't want your cries to be heard by our sister Zainab. Why, ya Aba Abdullah? Because I don't want Zainab to hear you are crying for me. And then Imam Hassan looks at Imam Hussein, he says, ya Aba Abdullah, la yawm ka yawmika ya Aba Abdullah. There will be no any other day compared to your day, O Aba Abdullah. Meaning what? My qadiyya is smaller and simple like yours. Yours will be a difficult one. And that's why we believe Imam Hassan alayhi salam left Qasim to be there to represent him. It is the qadiya when we cry because we want to be elevated to that position. So when we talk about al-buka, which is very important, عن زيد الشحام قال كنا عند أبي عبد الله جعفر الصادق عليه السلام ونحن جماعة من الكوفيين فدخل جعفر بن عفان على أبي عبد الله عليه السلام فقربه وأدناه ثم قال يا جعفر قال لبيك جعلني الله فداك قال بلغني أنك تقول الشعر في الحسين عليه السلام وتجيد فقال له نعم قال عليه السلام قل أو أنشدني من شعرك في الحسين عليه السلام فأنشده ومن حوله فبكى الإمام الصادق عليه السلام حتى سال الدموع على وجهه ولحيته. When we look at this hadith, we find that Zayd al-Shaham says, we were with Imam Abi Abdullah al-Husayn, Imam Abi Abdullah Ja'far al-Sadiq alayhi salam one day. When we were with him, Imam alayhi salam said, oh, Ja'far ibn Affan, I have heard that you write and you recite poems for Abu Abdullah al-Husayn. And I hear that you are good in that. Come closer. He made him to sit near him. And he said, can you recite some of your poems about Aba Abdullah? He started reciting the poems about Aba Abdullah al-Husayn. Imam Sadiq alayhi salam. And those who are with him, they started crying. Why? Because he recited the poems about the martyrdom of Aba Abdullah. What are we learning here? Imam Sadiq alayhi salam says, you can cry. No problem at all. However, when we cry, our qadiya is Abi Abdullah al-Husayn, not just a person of Husayn. It is the issue of Imam Abi Abdullah al-Husayn alayhi salam. And why, when we are in our ma'tam like this one, we try to make it dark to cry in order for us to remember the qadiya of Abi Abdullah al-Husayn alayhi salam. عن علي ابن إسماعيل التميمي عن أبيه عليه السلام يقول أن السيد الحميري مرة أراد أن يدخل في بيت الإمام الصادق عليه السلام ولما استأذن الإمام عليه السلام قال خلوه يدخل في البيت وإمام عليه السلام وضع الستار بينه وبين أهل بيته ودخل السيد الحميري والإمام عليه السلام قربه كذلك وقال أرجوك أن تقرأ الشعر حول الإمام الحسين عليه السلام أو استنشده الإمام الصادق. يعني ماذا؟ الإمام الصادق طلب منه أن ينشد شعرا فقال أمرر على جدة الحسين وقل لأعظمه الزكية أعظما لا زلت من وطفاء سابكة روية وإذا مررت بقبره فأطل به وقف المطية وابكي المطهر للمطهر والمطهرة النقية. When he recited this, Imam Sadiq alayhi salam cried a lot, and the people who are with him cried. And Imam alayhi salam had to say to Sayyid al-Himyari, please stop, because now you are making everyone not to control themselves because of what you have recited. In short, as Sayyid al-Himyari, he says that when you pass to the grave of Abi Abdullah, it is as if you are asking the bones which are buried there. Oh bones, are you still thirsty the way when you died you are thirsty? Allahu Akbar. Are you still thirsty the way you are buried when you are thirsty? Truly speaking, sometimes these poems are making us to see the picture in a different way. I know that the bodies, maybe some of the bodies are not there, Of course, the Masumin are there. He says, oh, the bones which are remaining, are you still thirsty the way you are buried here when you are thirsty? Until he says that, when you pass by the grave of Aba Abdullah, when you pass there, make sure you go slowly, stop, and prolong your stopping there. Why? Because you need to make sure you are talking to the one who is buried there and remember Abi Abdullah al-Hussein alayhi salam. And when we look at Imam al-Ridha, salawatullahi wa salamuhu alayhi, Allahumma salli ala Muhammadin wa ali Muhammad. Qissat di'bil al-Khuza'i ma'a al-Imam al-Ridha alayhi salam. لما أنشد القصيدة وقال مدارس آيات خلت من تلاوة ومنزل وحي مكفر العرصات. This is very important to me, wallah. When he reaches to the point, he says, أفاطم لو خلت الحسين مجدلا وقد مات عطشانا بشط فراتي إذان للطمت الخد فاطم عنده وأجريت دمع العين في الوجنات. When Di'bil al-Khuza'i talks to Imam al-Ridha alayhi salam, he says, now when I look to the houses where the angels used to come down and the revelations, now these houses are empty. No one is living there. Why? Because Ahlul Bayt alayhi salam have been killed. Until he says, Afatimu, Allahu Akbar, Di'bil al-Khuza'i, Afatimu, O Fatima, Law khiltil Husayna mujaddala. What does it mean? If you are there to see Hussein and the way his body was lying near Furat, waqad mata atshan bishatti Furati, he died while he was thirsty near the river Euphrates. Which river is this? Imam Amirul Mu'minin ruled Iraq for how many years? And he did not stop anyone to drink water. He says, Fatima, if you were there to see Hussein, the way they killed Aba Abdullah, and his body was lying near Furat, he died thirsty even though Furat was full of water. لَلَطَمْتِ الْخَدَّ فَاطِمْ عِنْدَهِ. You would slap your cheeks, Fatima, because of what you see there. وَأَجْرَيْتِ الدَّمْعَ فِي الْوَجَنَاتِ. And you would shed tears because of what you see with Aba Abdullah. I ask you, O brothers and sisters, now can you imagine, if this is imagination, imagine now the angels are going to talk to Fatima to Zahra, salamullahi alayha, after the death, after the martyrdom of Aba Abdullah, and the angels are saying to Fatima, oh Fatima, do you know that your son Hussein has been martyred? Let us take you with us up to Karbala. The angels are taking Fatima to Karbala. And now they say, this is Hussein. Look at Hussein. What would happen? Well, I ask sisters, if you have been participating in the janazah, sometimes when they say, come and see the dead body before we are going to bury, and the body is covered with kafan, they open the face, you look at the face of this mar'oom, many sisters don't control themselves, even if that who is lying there is their son. Why? Because they look at mayyit. Now imagine Fatima to Zahra. If the angels were to say, let's go now to Karbala. Oh Fatima, look at Hussein. Look the way they did to Aba Abdullah. Oh Fatima, look at Hussein. The way he was killed near Furat, Euphrates. They did not give any water to him. And Fatima looks at Hussein alayhi salam. If it is difficult for ladies to see the dead body with kafan, what would happen to Zahra alayhi salam? Now she's looking at Aba Abdullah. The way they have chopped his head, He is without the head, and Fatima is looking at Hussein. What would happen to Fatima? Definitely, Fatima would cry. And that's why Imam Zamanuna, Sahibu Zaman, Yaqul, if I would get the opportunity for me to wail for you, Aba Abdullah, La andubannaka sabahan wa masa'a, wa la abkiyanna alayka badala dumu'i dama. Oh Hussein, if I get the opportunity for me to wail for you, I will do that morning and evening. And instead for me to share the normal tears, I will cry for you. Instead of tears, I will shed the tears of blood. Wallahi, it is a musibah which makes us to believe that the calamity which befell Ahlul Bayt alayhim salam was big. When Imam Abi Abdullah al-Hussein alayhi salam was leaving Medina, he went to the grave of his grandfather Rasulullah. This was the last moment Imam Abi Abdullah is coming out of the city of Medina. According to the narration, it says Aba Abdullah was in the grave of Rasulullah and he was bidding farewell. Assalamu alayka ya Rasulullah. Salam alayka ya Rasulullah. This is the last salam. Then he fell asleep in the grave of Rasulullah. He saw Rasulullah, Zahra, father Ali ibn Abi Talib, Imam Hassan. They all saying, Akbil ilayna, come to us, ya Aba Abdullah. Then Imam alayhi salam, he wakes up. He goes to the graves of his brother in Jannatil Baqi to bid farewell. Can you imagine now, Imam Abi Abdullah is bidding farewell to his brother, that he's going away and he will not come back. Now definitely Imam Hussein alayhi salam is remembering his brother and the way they were living together. And now he is about to leave the city of Medina. But we hear that there was a young girl by the name Fatima. They say that this Fatima is known as Al-Alila. Fatima was ill. Fatima was not well. Fatima, the young Fatima, daughter of Imam Hussein alayhi salam, Imam is bidding farewell to Fatima, that I'm going and I will not come back, because why? I'm going to a place where I know my life will come to an end. Can you imagine Fatima Al-Alila, the young girl, now is without the father. Young Fatima is becoming yatim because the father is leaving for Karbala. And it is here when we remember this. Ya Aba Abdullah, how was it easy for you to leave Medina, to leave Rasulullah, to leave your mother Zahra, to leave Al-Hasan alayhi salam, and then you go, you are leaving this Fatima Al-Alila. It was a difficult one. And that's why when we remember Aba Abdullah by saying, Assalamu alayka ya Aba Abdullah, peace be upon you, O Aba Abdullah, peace be upon you, O Ibn Rasulillah, peace be upon you, O son of Ali al-Murtada, peace be upon you, O son of Fatima al-Zahra. It was difficult for you to leave the city of Medina. It was the difficult moment for you to leave Fatima al-Alila. But Imam Abi Abdullah managed to do that because it was Shahada. And it is Shahada which we need to remember. Inna lillah wa inna ilayhi raji'un. Wa sayalamu alladhina zalamu ala Muhammadin ayyamun qalabin yanqalib.